want to greet all of us in Jesus' name. It is very important that we can be alive and come to a time where we can listen to God speaking to us. I am going to speak to us on the title, By God's Word and Not by Calculations. We want to follow that title. We need to know that we are living in times that are unprecedented. In the history of this world, COVID-19 has never been. The economies of the world are no longer as functional as they used to be. Others who are studying the economies of this world say, we are in an economic coma, where companies have closed, people have lost their jobs, and the world over, each nation is trying to come up with mechanisms to control the infections caused by COVID-19. In times like this, how do we live? Is it by God's word or by making numerous calculations? In an environment that is unpredictable, how do we go ahead? That is what we want to look at. The book of Luke chapter 9 verse 12, this is what the Bible says. When the day began to wear away, the 12 came and said to him, send the multitude away, that they may go into the surrounding towns and country, and lodge and get provisions, for we are in a deserted place here. These are the disciples of Jesus Christ coming to him at an awkward time. Jesus had been ministering to many people, and as the day was drawing toward its end, this is what the disciples say to him. They come to the master of the universe, the creator himself, the Lord and Redeemer of humankind. They say to him, send this multitude away. And they give the reasons that they must go into the surrounding towns and country and find themselves a lodging place. Not only that, they must also get provisions. And the reasons they give for asking Jesus to send the multitude away is that the place where they were is a deserted place. They are in the regions of Bethsaida. This is where they are, a desolate place, a deserted place, according to the disciples. So there are two combinations that are bad that prompt the disciples to come to Jesus and ask him to send the people away. Number one, the hour is late. Number two, the place is deserted. So when it comes to the problem-solving techniques of these disciples, they say to deal with this problem of a late hour and a deserted place, number one, we have to send people away, or we have to raise enough money to buy a little for the people to eat. You know, Jesus was never part of their problem-solving possibilities. If he was part of their problem-solving possibilities, this is not the solution he would have given. But they go ahead and give solutions to a problem that is happening to people that had come to listen to the ministry of Jesus Christ. I want us to realize something as we study this passage. The crowds that are gathered were not local. This is why there is need for them to go and find food and find lodging. They don't live around this place. But to the crowds, Jesus seems to suggest, don't leave me for the villages. And when you read the book of Philippians chapter 3 verse 20, Paul says, our citizenship is in heaven, where our Redeemer is going to come from. And when he comes, he is going to transform our vile bodies to be like his glorious body because of the power that is in him, which power gives him the ability to transform us into the likeness of people who must live in the presence of God. So Paul says, our citizenship is not here, but it is in heaven. So for those people whose citizenship is in heaven, they don't need to leave Jesus Christ for the villages of Bethsaida to look for lodging or to look for provisions. It is only those whose citizenship is in this world who can go into the villages to look for lodges and to look for provisions. Those that are citizens of the kingdom that is coming, they need to stay where Jesus Christ is because he is everything. To us, I want to say, don't get carried away by the crowd, because the crowd is local. They may know where to get a lodging. They may know where to get some provisions. But for those who are waiting for the kingdom of heaven, we need to stay where Jesus Christ is. The place may be deserted, but as long as Jesus is with us in that deserted place, that is the best place for us to stay. I want to say to us, even as we go through these challenging moments of the history of this world, the world may become like a desert. Provisions are no longer there. Jobs are no longer there. Companies have closed down. Your future seems bleak. You don't even know where the next meal will come from. And in that situation, suggestions from all over will come to us to give us possibilities and solutions to our challenges. My advice to you is never leave where Jesus Christ is. I want us to see the tragedy of great proportions that the disciples are suggesting to Jesus Christ. Send people away. This is a tragedy. How do you send people away from the source of life? When you read Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, this is what the Bible says about Jesus. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. You know, when Paul says he is the firstborn of all creation, he is not saying firstborn in the sense that he was the first to be created. No, he is using that word to describe Jesus Christ as the source of everything that has been created. You will notice, Paul goes further to say, for by him, that is Jesus Christ, all things were created and are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. So he is the source. He is the beginning. He is the foundation. He is the cause for everything that is there. So how do you leave the source of everything to go into the villages to look for lodging or to look for provisions? Temptations are all over for us not to trust Jesus or to begin to trust other sources of power. Yes, there may be other sources of other powers. But when it comes to power that sustains, power that gives life, power that gives eternity, that power resides in Jesus Christ. That is why as we go through these tough times in our world, in your situation, let's never join this suggestion. It is tragic to go away from Jesus Christ, who is the source. Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters, is the head. He's the source. He is the Amen. He is the faithful witness. He is the beginning of the creation of God, according to Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. This is how Jesus Christ is painted by the Revelator. The faithful witness. He is the beginning of creation. So there is nothing that was created that begins from elsewhere apart from Jesus Christ, who is the head or the source. This Jesus, my brothers and sisters, from whom the disciples are suggesting that people go away, is the stone that was rejected by the builders. Yet the very stone rejected by the builders became the head of the corner. Yes, many people in our world may not see Jesus Christ as the answer. They may not see him as the source. They may not see him as the solution. But I want to say to you, see Jesus Christ as everything, as the source, as the sustainer, as the founder of anything that has lasting effects. I want us to look at a few facts before we go further. Fact number one, as we were studying this passage, shows us that there are no provisions and lodging apart from Jesus. Yes, disciples are suggesting that, but the fact is, there is no provision, there is no lodging apart from Jesus. When you look at Matthew chapter 14, verse 16, this is what the Bible record says. But Jesus said to them, they need not go away. You give them something to eat. This is Jesus now challenging the disciples. Guys, you have been with me for quite some time. You have seen what I could do, what I can do, what I am able to do. The time I have lived with you, I have given you enough evidence that there is no situation that is above me. So don't send people away from me. Instead, if you have faith, if you believe in who I am, you give them something to eat. Jesus Christ is challenging them. If you trust in who I am, you can give them something to eat. You remember, for 40 years, Jesus provided for over a million people in the wilderness as Israel was moving from the land of Canaan to from the land of Egypt to the land of Canaan, traversing a desert. It is Jesus who provided for over a million people. Now, if he was able to provide for over a million people for 40 years, what about these few thousands that are gathered around him in this desert place? He can still do the same. Because Paul in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1 to 4, tells us, for these 40 years, it was Jesus Christ who was giving them everything that they required. When they needed water, Jesus Christ gave them water. When they needed food, Jesus gave them bread from heaven. This is the source. And the disciples say, then people can get provisions and lodging apart from Jesus Christ. Remember, when you read Acts chapter 7, verse 38, the Bible tells us it is Jesus who was in the desert with the church. That is, for 40 years, Jesus Christ was leading the church from Egypt to Canaan. You will notice when you read Exodus chapter 16, verse number 35, the Bible says, and the children of Israel ate manna until they came to an inhabited land. They ate manna until they came to the border of the land of Canaan. What is the same? 40 years without any problem of food in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening. 40 years. Jesus carries the economy for his people for as long as they are still on this earth. As long as they have not yet reached the land of Canaan, no matter the deserts they pass through, no matter the valleys they must pass through, he is the source. He has enough provision for each of his children. Ours is just to trust him, and never to leave him. You know, this mistake that the disciples are suggesting here is the same mistake that Elimelech made. He left Bethlehem Judah. And Bethlehem Judah means the house of bread. He went to mourn because there was famine in the land. But although there is famine in Bethlehem of Judah, but the name it carries, that it is the house of bread, should have suggested to Elimelech and his household that I cannot leave the house of bread for more. He went to diaspora. You know, it's not in the diaspora, but it is in Jesus Christ. I want us to look at Moses' benediction when you read Deuteronomy chapter 33. Verse 26 to 28, he gives us a benediction as he gives the children of Israel when he was soon to part from them. And I like his testamentary. This is how it reads. He says, you know, he is talking about God. There is none like the God of Jeshurun, who rides the heavens to help, and through the skies in his majesty. The eternal God is a dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. And he drove out the enemy from before you and said, destroy. Verse 28 says, so Israel dwells in security, the fountain of Jacob secluded, in a land of grain and new wine. His heavens also drop down to. This is Moses' testamentary about God. You see, you don't need to leave such a God. Jeshurun is the upright one, the God of Jeshurun, the God of the upright one. He rides on pillar of fire and the cloud as he is leading the children of Israel from Egypt to Canaan. He is the fountain of Jacob, the source. So the posterity of Israel shall dwell in a blessed and favored land. You may be in a desert. You may be unemployed. But if you keep right with God through what Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross, and you become the upright one, you become Jeshurun, then this God of Jeshurun will be your help. He will be your dwelling place. The fountain of Jacob will live in a land of grain and new wine. Even as they are going through the desert, the Bible says they will live in a land of grain and new wine. And his heavens will drop new joy. We need this kind of a Savior who, even as we go through tough moments of life, we can live, be surrounded by grain and new wine, from which those that don't believe will not understand how we are being sustained. No matter what problems, no matter what adversity, Israel would encounter God, they would instantly come with power to help. So if we encounter God, my brothers and sisters, as we go through whatever problem we have, the moment we encounter God, we will be protected. So let's not depart from Jesus. The favorite writer in the book Desire of Ages, page 369, says this: and when we are brought into strange places, we are to depend on God. We are to exercise wisdom and judgment in every action of life, that we may not, by reckless movements, place ourselves in trial. We are not to plunge into difficulties, neglecting the means God has provided and missing the faculties he has given us. I like this. May we ponder upon this. When we are brought into strange places, depend on God. We were dealing with fact number one. Let's look at fact number two. Be away from peoples and places, but never from Jesus' presence. You can be away from people and from places, but never from the presence of Jesus. I will quote an example in the Bible. There is Elijah being wanted by the king to be killed by the king for pronouncing and calling for a 3.5-year drought. He becomes a wanted person. But you will notice when we get to 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 3 to 6, when he is away from people and places, God sends unlikely sources to provide him with his portion of food in the form of ravens. Ravens carry food from one place to where Elijah is. And the Bible record tells us he is at the river Kerit. There is a pool of water there. Food is being brought by ravens, faithfully bringing food. And as they bring food to Elijah, Elijah drinks from that well. What do we see here? We are seeing ministry without the church. Because sometimes we may cheat ourselves to think those that minister for God are sustained by us. No, they are sustained by God himself. Here is the demonstration. Elijah, the minister of God, in the 3.5-year drought, he is sustained not by the church at this time, but by God himself through unlikely sources. But let me underscore a point for our pondering. Where the ravens are coming from, God is providing food for Elijah, but there is no water for the ravens. So for ravens to get water, they must obey the instruction of God. Carrying food for God's minister as they deliver Elijah's food, they also get water to deal with their thirst. So the moment we obey God, God also addresses those things we cannot address apart from obeying God. So ravens cannot be more faithful to God than us. This is one of the meanest birds, a bird which does not give. But upon hearing what God wants this bird to do, even the mean raven follows God's instruction and delivers the provisions for the Savior. As we go through these difficult moments, don't be mean. Deliver to God, deliver to his ministry what he says must be delivered in the form of tithes and offerings. And all those resources that God requires for special projects, deliver them. As you deliver them to the ministry of God, God is going to address that which COVID pandemic has caused in your life. But when we came to 1 Kings 17, verse 8 to 16, you remember the pool at Kerit dried. And God says to Elijah, lest you may think I am a limited God, now that the brook has dried up, I am still God. Move to another place. I have already prepared a place for you. So when he goes to the widow of Zarephath, the Bible says to us, as he is getting there, she meets this woman whose resources are almost finished. And the widow says to Elijah, I am just getting these sticks of wood so that I just prepare the last meal for myself and my son so that we die. So God has taken Elijah to a place where there is destitution, where death is already in the horizon, where sustenance for this widow and the little son has come to an end. There is now nothing.
and God sends Elijah to that place.
This helps us to see the kind of God that we worship.
And you remember those that read the word of God. This is where Elijah says to this woman, before you prepare something for yourself and for your son, begin to make a little cake for me, and then prepare for yourself and your son.
There's already
some information which is fascinating. The widow says, there is only enough meal to cook for the last time. But Elijah says, yes, if you are cooking for yourself and for your son, you are cooking for the last time. But if you bring God in the picture, you will not cook once. You will cook for God's person, and then you cook for yourself. So, the choice was to this woman either to cook once in her situation or to accept what the man of God is saying. Cook for me and you cook for your son. So there is provision. Here is the law, not the law of multiplication, but the law, not the law of addition, but the law of multiplication. If we are where Jesus Christ is, his presence will change our situation. So we see now here a story of ministry with the church. But the church here is only made up of two poor people. So really, who is being helped here? Who is helping who? It is God helping this poor widow. How is God helping this poor widow? By bringing his ministry to this poor woman. As this woman attempts in her small resources to address the needs of the minister, in essence, God is ministering to the person who was to die. So may God help us to know that as we do something for the ministry, as we do something to advance mission, as we sacrifice to advance mission in these last days, in spite of our situation, in spite of our privation, in spite of our small resources, the moment we sacrifice for mission, God preserves us through our sacrifice for mission. So sustenance for God's people is there on condition they are there to support the mission that God once done. From that time, many of his disciples went back and went with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. John chapter 6, verse 66 to 69. Peter says, we have come to believe and know. This is a fundamental principle, to know and to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Once we have this belief in us, once we know this, there may be challenges in our world, in our homes, in our personal lives. But once we know and believe that Christ is the Son of the living God, we are home and dry. There is no place apart from Jesus where we can go. Why? He is eternal life. He is the words of life. This is why Isaac in Genesis 26, during a hot famine, as he was trying to go to Egypt, like all the other patriarchs had done, the word of God says to him, don't go to Egypt. Stay in the land. I will show you where to stay and what to do, and I will bless you. And when Isaac obeyed God, the rest of the story, you know, he sowed in the land. He acted upon his faith. He acted upon the trust that he had on God. He sowed in a land of famine. And what does the Bible record say? The Bible says, because of sowing and because of his trust in God, God came in to support his faith and his trust. And in a single year, in a single season, the Bible says, His harvest was a hundredfold. He became rich, mightily rich, exceedingly rich in servants, in livestock, in grain, and in everything until his enemies envied him. So, stay where Jesus is. Fact number three. Life is not lived by calculations. It is lived by God's word. You will notice in this passage we are studying, Jesus brings a very interrogative question to his disciples. This is what John 6:5 says. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" An interrogative question. Philip quickly engages his calculator and not his faith. Upon calculation, Philip says, even 200 denarii worth of food is insufficient even for each one of these persons just to have a bite. These are the challenges of calculators. You know, those that are calculative, they don't tithe, they don't offer sacrificial, they don't even keep the Sabbath. Because they fear, if I keep the Sabbath, I will not be able to get money that I should get on the Sabbath. They don't surrender fully to the Lordship of Jesus. This is why you will see that in this passage, men of means, instead of looking at what they have in their small lunch boxes, they look to the little boy's lunch. This is what happens if we are calculating. Life is not by calculations, but by God's word. A few questions. Was buying food necessary? Because Philip is suggesting buying of food. But the question, was buying food in this instance necessary? Philip should have known better. Did they buy wine at Cana when there was that shortage of wine in John chapter 2? Didn't Jesus Christ provide choice wine? Why has Philip forgotten? Remember, the power of Jesus surpasses all the calculations of the world combined. The problem of the disciples is also our problem. They all calculated and failed to exercise faith. They did not have faith that people could be fed from nothing. We need to have faith that we can still be sustained by God when industries are shut, when companies are no longer operational, when we have lost our jobs, when we are surrounded by lockdowns day in, day out. We need to have faith that we can still be fed from nothing as long as Jesus Christ, the source of life, is with us. The disciples' problems, my brothers and sisters, is that they concentrated all their attention to the large, hungry crowd. Don't concentrate on large crowds. Don't concentrate on the hungry people. They forgot about Jesus' power and his love. They focused on the limited resources of bread and fish. They forgot the unlimited resource that Jesus provides by his person. Let's look at fact number four. Disciples had not yet looked at life through the eyes of Jesus. As we traverse this world, may God help us to look at life and all its puzzles and its challenges, not through our eyes, not through economic or scientific eyes, but let's look at life through the eyes of Jesus. Disciples think they are in a wrong place at a wrong time, and nothing could happen. You can imagine, when you look at things from your own eyes, you begin to say, I think I am in a wrong country. I think I joined the wrong profession. I think I am married to the wrong person. These are assumptions that begin to come if we look at life apart from Jesus. Let's look at life through the eyes of Jesus. When Jesus looked at the same situation, looking at that large crowd that was coming, a hungry crowd, when Jesus looked at that crowd, He saw the situation like the disciples saw, not as a problem, but as an opportunity to trust and glorify the Father. You remember when Paul was in his dungeon, he writes a letter to the church of Philippi, and he says, "My brethren, don't mourn over my imprisonment. Actually, what has happened is, through my imprisonment, this God has given me an opportunity for the furtherance of his gospel. And because of my imprisonment, Jesus is now known even in the household of Caesar. And those that were weak in the faith, because of my imprisonment, have become bold to proclaim the risen Savior." So in other words, Paul says to us, difficult situations must be seen as opportunities to further the gospel of God. My brothers and sisters, as well as those that lead the church of God, an effective leader sees potential in a problem and is willing to act by faith. A few lessons. Do not begin by measuring resources, but determine God's will and trust Him to meet the need. The miracle took place in His hands, that is Jesus' hands, not in the disciples' hands. I want us to underscore a point here. Once we know where miracles take place, we will leave this world with ease. I want to repeat, the miracle took place in Jesus' hands, not in their hands. What had happened? For they brought the bread and fish to Him. Listen to this. Whatever we give to Him, He can bless and multiply. I know we all need blessings. We all need multiplication of what we have. But here is the secret. Things don't multiply in our hands. They multiply as we put those little resources into His hands. Then the multiplication effect begins to happen. This is why in moments like these ones, these are the times we must be more determined to be sacrificial in returning to God what belongs to Him, so that He can give to us that which can sustain our lives. Remember, we are not manufacturers, we are only distributors. So if there is a time we have to be distributors, then no other time in history. It is when everybody else is asking, let's be God's distribution centers, and you will enjoy His manifold blessings. We want to end after looking at the situation in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 42. The prophet of God comes to his servant and says, "Get these 20 loaves of bread and give them to these 100 men." But the servant said, "What? Shall I set this before 100 men?" He said again, "Give it to the people, that they may eat, for thus saith the Lord, they shall eat and have some left over." That's verse 43. So he set it before them, and they ate and had some left over, according to the word of the Lord. That's verse 44. We want to contrast this with what Philip said in Luke chapter 9, verse 17, where he had said, "They, even if we buy food worth 200 denarii, they will not each have a bite." Here we have 100 men, not only having each a bite, but eating to the full and having leftovers. Let's now go back to the crowd. Verse 17 of Luke 9 says, "So they all ate and were filled, and 12 baskets of leftover fragments were taken up by them." The means in our possession, Ellen White says, may not seem to be sufficient for the work, but if we will move forward by faith, believing in the all-sufficient power of God, abundant resources will open before us. If the work be of God, He Himself will provide the means for its accomplishment. Both for the work of God and for those that want to be used by God to support mission, resources will be abundant. So COVID-19 does not have power to stop that which God wants to do for mission. To stop that which God wants to give his people in any situation. In their desert, in their joblessness, in their bereavement, Jesus Christ cannot be stopped by any situation. The multiplication effect, like we have already said, it's not in our hands, but in Jesus' hands. The food multiplied in his hands, and the hands of the disciples reaching out to Christ himself, the bread of life, were never empty. I want to say, if we want our hands never to be empty in any situation, let's always reach out to Christ himself, who is the bread of life, and our hands will never be empty. The little store was sufficient for all. After the wants of the people had been supplied, the fragments were gathered up, and Christ and his disciples ate together of the precious heaven-supplied food. That's Desire of Ages, page 370. I want to appeal to somebody as I pray. Your personal life may be desolate now. May be like the bitter water of manna. It may be like the widow whose sons were on the creditors list. That's your life. That's my life. Life may be at risk. You may be going through debt. I want to say to you, put yourself and your little resources into his hands. And like he provided breakfast to the disciples in John 21, verse 9 to 13, he will do the same to those whose faith prompts them to put themselves and their resources into his hands. I know this is your prayer, that you want to put yourself and your mere resources into his hands. If that is your prayer, I am praying, but pray also in your heart and say to him, Lord, I surrender myself to you. And the little tithes and offerings and special offerings for special projects, I surrender to you. You do the rest for me. I can assure you, God will do it. We are praying now. Our gracious Father in heaven, we thank you for this passage of scripture that you have brought to us, which teaches us to trust you, to have faith in you, never to depart from you, but to stay put where you are, because your presence is everything. Your presence is better than places and people. Give us that faith. Give us that repentance to know you and to believe in you, that you are the Son of the living God, and that you are the source, the fountain of eternal life. As we go through these difficult times in our personal lives, as families, as a church, as individuals, may you help us to trust you. Thank you, Father, for what you are going to do for us as we go through this barren place. May you be our unending fountain, like you were the God of Jeshurun. May you be the same to us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.